Hey, everybody. So, you know, I have 30 minutes, and I see 18 people online. There were about 60 people who had joined, so I guess they'll be coming along. So 30 minutes is really short time. Actually, I practiced it yesterday, so I know exactly how many minutes, how many words per second I have to speak. So I'm going to get started right away. So welcome. Thank you very much for joining. I was last week in presenting in London for a conference of deep learning, and to a bunch of researchers, company people were also there, large enterprises. And it was a rushed kind of presentation, so I had to fly back very quickly to Amsterdam. So I decided to publish this on internet to a wider audience so they can view it, what I had presented, and hopefully also comment back. So my talk is going to be about two to three main topics. So the next slide, if you can see here. So, you know, basically about the history and the role of mathematicians in deep learning, really important. The second, what I'm going to talk about is a practical example from a computational biology field that is emerging. If you are watching computational biology, do look at deep learning. There's a whole lot of work going on there, yeah? What I'm going to explain is the evolution of how deep learning is increasingly being used as compared to machine learning. If time permits, I want to take up also a very important topic called, the industry and the companies that you guys work for, and why the heck are these guys taking so long to really adopt artificial intelligence and deep learning at scale, like companies like Amazon, Google, Facebook, and the most important thing is whether a company or not, kind of takes action, it's up to you, and you have to take action. And I'm going to give you a quick advice to, you know, why you should stop wasting your time if you are and move fast to learn these new skills. So I hope to address these things in the next couple of 30 minutes. I'll try to finish it in about 20 to 25 minutes if that works. If that does not work, then you can definitely, you keep posting your questions. You can add your questions, and I will address your questions later on in a blog post. So let's get started. So quick housekeeping, just make sure, I'm not sure if you have any problems with your mobile phones or something in the audio. I haven't used the platform in the last 9 years, so I wouldn't know if there are any problems. Keep your questions till the end. All right, so let's move on. Obviously, the first step is mathematics and the love, and obviously the hate of mathematics that most of us have been experiencing in high school and college. So just a little bit of a fun thing, you know, if you look at on the right side, you know, our obsession with mathematics is really old. It's been, you know, it's an age-old obsession. If you look at the right, you see the concept of zero in the red kind of, you know, the comment that I have here is the number 270. Some say it's 290. Originated in India in Gwalior. It's about 260 kilometers from Delhi. So the oldest zero. You know, which not only contributes to the place value number system, which was popular in China and Babylon long time ago, but, you know, it came from India. So the zero definitely has a great contribution to mathematical history, which we will not cover in this topic, but just to let you know, fun fact. On the right side, you see a tablet you may have seen in the news the last couple of days and weeks, you know, the Plimpton 322, which was recently, you know, is being continuously being deciphered, and one of the, you know, the deciphering is that Pythagoras obviously is not really the father of trigonometry, the Babylonians were. So moving on. All right. So, you know, it's all about associationism, and I'm going to explain this in a later, in the next slide. So besides, you know, the math of zero, it also has a symbolic meaning from an Indian perspective. Zero actually means shunya. Shunya basically means salvation and nirvana. So if you nullify your desires and you're ready, you know, you're basically ready for salvation. Obviously, we're not going to go into that concept. It's a bit too heady. What I can tell you is that zero and infinity are probably the greatest conceptual leaps in the history of mathematics. But we definitely obviously have to thank to the Babylonians and Egyptians because they were the ones who gave meaning to math in terms of material science and sense, right? So three apples and 12 bananas is 15 fruit is the way of doing math, sort of, you know, a linear equation. And the Greeks obviously gave us, you know, the tremendous abstraction. So we went too heavily into abstraction. So we thank, obviously, extremely thankful to both sides of the coin. But going back into the history of deep learning, as you can see, Aristotle back in 300 BC already was a, you know, huge proponent of associationism, which I'll come back to you. So that's four laws of associationism, which we continuously use today in our heads and also in neural networks today. Okay. So So, you know, we're going to go through, do a quick whirlwind kind of a tour into the history of deep learning until the, let's say, the 18th century for whatever that is known to mankind or and to us. There was not much activity going on there. In 1873, Alexander Blaine, he introduced, you know, he actually first described the neural network grouping. McCulloch and Pitts, they came up with the first artificial neural network model a long time ago. Donald Hebb in 1949, he gave us the kind of Bayes distribution. He was, you know, some people say he's the father of neural network, you know, good enough. But obviously he was the one who was able to give the Bayes distribution, which we're going to look into. You know, there was a challenge as well with that. Paul Werbus, he introduced backpropagation. 1987, Boltzmann machine came in. And then we had Smolensky brought into harmonium, which we also, next slide, that is, yes. So, you know, known as harmonium, which is basically restricted Boltzmann machines. Don't worry too much about these complex concepts. If you haven't understood that, it's no big deal. So basically when you start getting deeper into deep learning and all that stuff, you know, you're going to understand it. So just keep, you know, just flow along with me and just see how the history is kind of evolved. 1985, you know, Boltzmann machines, Smolensky, harmonium, as I said, Hinton, Rommelhart, you know, they gave back propagation, part two. Obviously, Paul Werbus was the first one. Jan Lucken was the first guy to, you know, right now he works for Facebook. He's, you know, he had artificial intelligence in it. So he gave the deep neural networks in practice with his Lynette data sets. 1997, LSTM, long short-term memory, you know, helped us with fixing the vanishing gradients. And in 2006, you know, something happened. So basically, Hinton kind of took this and he kind of ran with it. So there are a couple of things he did. You know, he's on it the last 11 years, which is amazing effort for someone who's, you know, who's kind of relentless to try to understand. Being a philosopher, if you didn't know, he studied from University of Edinburgh. One of the gentlemen, actually, I met last week, you know, has been there and is from his tight era. So what he gave us is deep belief nets, and we had, you know, deep Boltzmann machines. He gave us dropout and capsules, which we're not going to discuss. It's a really, really amazing subject, but not going to go. So capsule networks, you may have seen or may not have heard, is something really super exciting that has happened in the last couple of weeks. Okay, so, you know, this is fine. So what it basically means is, as Donald Hebb once said, fire together, wire together. Neurons that are closer to each other, they understand each other, and that's why we make decisions in life. Anything, you know, things like, I don't know why you came to this conference. There must have been something you may have sort of been triggered, that who is this guy? Some other associations. So associationism, and I will not go into detail, which you should really look it up, about contiguity, frequency, similarity, and contrast. So very quickly saying, you know what this basically means is, there are events that happen in spatial and temporal proximity, and that's how you associate things in your mind. The frequency, you know, the more they often happen, you know, the proportionality and the strength of your decision-making or whatever that you do in your life with two or more events, it increases. So increase in frequency. Similarity, one similar event leads to the second similar event. You're used to it. You know, when you buy a product on the online, they say, hey, maybe you would want to buy socks because you bought shoes. You know, the funny thing is brain doesn't work that way. Contrast is exactly what contradicts everything that you do. So you have something, you can look at something which you say, hey, this is a nice thing, but you will, you know, be triggered for a totally opposite thought. That is contrast. That's what Aristotle wrote, you know, 2,400 years ago. Can you imagine? But, you know, it's not all new. So if you look at Bayes' neural grouping in 1873, you know, on the right-hand side, you see, you know, the network grouping is kind of similar to what you have today. Hebbian, as I mentioned, we mentioned, you know, Donald Hebb, he came up with a dilemma where we had a huge problem with exploding weights. You know, you could not have, for instance, similarity and the contiguity, for instance, from Aristotle's principles, just keep on and on and on. You will not be able to contain those thoughts. Your brain is going to explode, so you need to normalize. So unfortunately, thankfully, Erki Oja, 69, I think he's about 70 years old, similar from the same age group and era as Geoffrey Hinton, a quiet, you know, decent, very, very, you know, just like obviously Geoffrey Hinton, a smart individual from Finland, and he brought the normalization, so he normalized the weights, and eventually also with the principal component analyzer he went through. Now, finally, if you look at the bottom side of the slide, what you're going to see is that Rosenblatt's organization of perceptron is not any different from how we, our current neural network model, for those who are used to it. So basically, what I'm trying to say in all this is, you know, historical perspective is very important. Our intuitions that are coming from our current readings and the readings in the past, we need to kind of understand the aspect of associationism. That is the most important thing, actually. And if you will read more books, I will not get into that, you know, things about how we are trying to understand the multidimensional capability of human brain, a part of my project, which I will also elucidate in any other different talks, is exactly what these four components and brain research neuroscientists, all these people are working on those concepts. I see one question online. Great, awesome. So heading to next. Okay, tensors. So some people may have heard, you heard of a tensor flow. You say, well, you know, what the heck is that? So tensors are not new either. They have been used in physics to encode fundamental quantities. So here's an example of a stress tensor, which you see, you know, cube, which is used frequently in material science for those people who have physics background. Quantum gravity example is also there. I'm going to come to that. Now, to define the stress at a point, so basically the stress tensor defines the stress, at a point within a material. And this is a two tensor and of a shape 3x3, as you can see already. So also, you know, the formula, so let's go to the formula. So let's not get, you know, the tensor, you should be able to read it. This I picked it up from Wikipedia. The formula below is really important for a couple of reasons I'm going to tell you. So that is, if you, some of you people may have seen, is EFE, or as we know it, it's Einstein's field equation represented in a tensor format. So I'll just go very quickly to these definitions. So RU mu V is a Ricci curvature tensor. G mu V is a metric tensor, and the rest are scalars. Now, there's a subtle difference here, but we don't need to cover that now because, you know, it's a complex topic. It's a huge topic. So, but what we do see is that modern tensor calculus systems like TensorFlow, you know, now we come to the software that probably you use today. The good news is this. So some of those tensor maths from physics is able to solve the problems of image processing, NLP, and the stuff that you use today. It is. But not all of it is there. So we're still in a bit of a limited zone, and we hope to see more tensor calculus coming in. I think, you know, TensorFlow is, and all the other kind of frameworks as well, right? So PyTorch uses tensor as well. MXNet and all these other kind of frameworks do use that as well. So it's not just TensorFlow is the only, you know, the godfather of tensor in terms of using software computational capabilities. As a side effect or a side sort of interesting fact is tensor, you know, is origination of, you know, Cauchy back in the 19th century, Ricci, even Roger Penrose were people who have understood the red books and brain and all those, you know, lovely ideas. They have continuously used tensors in their calculations. And let's not forget, I haven't mentioned, obviously, Carl Friedrich Gauss and Bernard Riemann, you know, the guys who gave us the curvature, which I will also have a, you know, sort of a chapter in my book where I actually sort of fondly call them the curvature boys, because they really gave us a really interesting thing. So once again, coming back to the Einstein's formula. So what besides the understanding of the tensor, which I just gave you, so basically what I'm going to come to the next part of the section on deep learning is that this formula, which was made and created out of intuitions and his passion for physics, and if you have studied and if you enjoy reading Einstein, you will really understand that just a bunch of intuitions, once again, you know, associationism, he was able to kind of decipher and understand and basically create a formula, both the right and the left side of the formula. And things like, if you know, physics guys with a physics background would know that things, you know, things which Newton didn't understand, and a lot of people didn't understand what the strange orbital position of Mercury. And also recently in 2015, you know, when we discovered that, yeah, there are gravitation waves, you know, this was predicted in 1915 already when this formula or when this equation was written, EFE was written. But in 2015, two black holes, you know, about 1.3 billion light years away, when they all kind of, you know, exploded, and we experienced the gravitational waves, you know, there were two LIDO stations in U.S. who measured that. It was predicted precisely based on the formula that was written more than 100 years ago. So what I'm trying to say is this. We can solve a whole lot of problems from deep learning if we see you know, what is, you know, all the work that has been done from the past, from intuitions, from ideas to formulas to testing and to making it work, that this is going to help us solve secrets. it's going to even unravel mysteries that are today, you know, for us, we don't know. I have no idea how things work. I don't know why this customer would do that thing. And, you know, from basic fundamental conceptual conventional things, we will move into understanding the secrets and mysteries as well. You know, having all given all that, you know, amazing kind of a pitch about deep learning, now you come to this. So you go like, wow, so what is this? You know, you're thrown with a whole lot of jargon. Obviously, this is not jargon. All this stuff is being used in deep learning. And I picked this up. This is probably the only sales kind of slide that I have in this section. So basically, what I'm trying to say is this. You know, we need to understand these terminologies. This work of all the terminologies is the work of hundreds of years of effort that people, mathematicians, mathematical physics, Boltzmann with his statistical thermodynamic background, has given us. Okay, so what we are gonna do, let's move on to the next slide. Cool, so you know, this is a computational biology kind of sort of discussion, so I'll make it interesting for you. I see you have 14 minutes, I'm gonna go fast with this. So basically, you know, in machine learning, and this is sort of gene genomics, a regulatory genomics example, and there is a, on the slide you can see at the bottom, you can download the document, research document as well. It's done by a very smart guy who's right now working for Google Brain in the healthcare division, and so I, you know, borrowed this intuition from him and obviously the research. So machine learning, let's, you know, take a step back and see what it is about. Machine learning and representation learning can be seen as follows. As you can see, you pre-process data. Guys who have done that, you can see that. Extract new features, you learn a model, and you evaluate, and basically rinse and repeat. So basically you do that until you have better sort of results or the results that you expect them to be, right? And if you look at the B section, bottom left, you see it's broken down into supervised and unsupervised. Machine learning, as most of the work that is done there, is supervised. So it has observed labels. And when you look on the right side, you see PCA factor, factorization, clustering, outlier detection, et cetera, obviously, are things that we don't know. We don't know what to label because we don't know what an outlier is. We have no idea which kind of a mutation is happening in a cell, so we would know that. And that is exactly where deep learning comes in. So what? So deep learning, what it does is it looks better as it can, you know, be seen if you look on the right side, and I will point to the right direction. So if you look at the very right, bottom right, so what it does is it uses hierarchical structures, as you can see in the bottom right, and it also uses high-level feature extraction, which you see the graph plot, the right part of the graph plot, not on the right, the left one, which does the, you know, classification based on machine learning. So what it does is it extracts using deep learning, capable of discriminating between classes. So, you know, this is just intron and exon, but you can have more classes, as you see on the extreme bottom right. You know, you can have TSS, intron, exons, and probably more in many more layers now. So this is what we have been doing. So machine learning has been used. Now, what happened now? So, you know, going into artificial neural network, a just brief introduction, as, you know, I showed you previously, you know, it's the brainchild of our predecessors, McCulloch and Pitts and Farley, Clark, 1957, I think. Rosenblatt with his perceptron. So basically what you see here is a network gets data from an input layer. It gets transferred in a non-linear way through multiple hidden layers. You see, just see one layer, but this is for example. And then the output of the previous layer is input for the next, which you may have known if you have read something about deep learning, have followed one of those, you know, online courses. So in the panel B, what you see basically is a representation of each neuron computing weights, weighted sum of inputs, excuse me. And basically what it does is it applies nonlinear activation function. You know, you have nonlinear activation functions like sigmoid, ReLU, TanH, CellU as well. I believe some people are trying to use that to calculate the output. ReLU is primarily used mostly because the output's kind of, you know, eliminates the negativity or the, removes the negative features, and then you are able to move faster with it. So, so what happens is this. If you look back at the forward propagation part of the bottom left, so the predicted label is compared to the true label to compute the loss for the current set of model weights, and the loss is then eventually back propagated through the neural network to compute the gradients of the loss function, right? And what it does is then it updates the weights, and the loss function is optimized using gradient-based descent, as you can see at the bottom right. And in each step, as you can see, the current weighted vector, you know, the one with the arrow, is moving to the steepest descent. So it's 190 degrees, up against the curve that it is lying against, the red ball, the DW, the differential of it, and the direction arrow, hopefully, approaching the global minimum. So we still are kind of trying to find out if we can able, you know, if you just look at the hill perspective, literally, if you throw a ball down a hill and you expect it to reach the bottom, the ground truth. And what also happens is a decaying learning rate over time. These are the things you should be able to do to optimize your model. And fine-tuning parameters and playing with better optimizers like Adam, for instance, or Nesterov, or several other models that there are optimizers that are out there, you're able to make your deep learning exploration journey to reach to better results. So, okay, well, you're going to say, well, fine, you know, okay, we've seen machine learning, we've seen deep learning, big deal. So basically, you know, it's fine, but so what's the big deal? This is CNN, so I'll try to see if I can, you know, give you guys a presentation on CNN, which is convolutional neural network, not the TV news station. So what we are seeing here is let's just go to the understanding of the data and the inputs that came from the genomics part. So basically what we are seeing here is in the regulatory genomics, researchers, neuroscientists, computational biologists are increasingly abandoning machine learning. And this is not like abandoning as if they don't want to use it. They use a lot of different beautiful parts of machine learning. But they are, let's say, leaving and moving on to more better evolved models in deep learning where what they did is this. This is really amazing. And I told actually in the presentation also a couple of days ago. So without changing the input features, what they did is, in the CNN, you know, fully connected, they fed this into a fully connected feed-forward network to predict the splicing activity of individual exons. Now, this model was trained using more than 1,000 predefined features. Okay, so that's there in the research report. This is not me imagining stuff. And it was extracted from candidate exons and introns, the example that I gave you with a machine learning perspective. And just note this. This is probably the most important for people who have been kind of, you know, having the scaremongering and saying that things don't work and deep learning is not something which is working. Now, just with a really low number of training samples, and this is 10,700 training samples in combination with model complexity, this model achieved higher prediction accuracy of splicing activity compared to previous methods. And I think, you know, if you look at it, and it really blows my mind away, and I have a trove of data, trove of you know, biocomputational work, which I have just set up a GitHub, actually. I posted it on LinkedIn. There is a ton of activity that is exposing us to the benefits and the usefulness of deep learning, which we, for very good reason, should challenge. Even the best philosophers, computational scientists, neuroscientists are challenging. Geoffrey Hinton himself is saying, you know, well, Bragg prop doesn't work. And this is what a true scientist and a researcher does. We are constantly in search of truth. And I think what I'm telling you is that this is, you know, a breakthrough, and we are coming to a breakthrough if you follow the news, and I hope that you read research documents and not news and media. You're going to see that work in, for instance, pneumonia. There is, I've posted a project which, you know, Andrew and a couple of other guys have just really recently launched called CAPS. No, that's not CAPS, excuse me. It's chestnet, so it's about pneumonia. There's a whole lot of cancer research being done, and I'm putting up, you know, projects. So this is, you know, pure showing you guys what's happening. So there's a whole lot of work going on. So I have a beautiful definition of CNN. I won't tell you this, but I'll just tell you this. The CNN, or convolutional neural network, is an evolution. It is an improvement on the work that we have done in the past. And very briefly, in a nutshell, it was work done in the late 50s by Hubel and Wiesel. What they did is they inserted microscopic electrodes in a visual cortex of cats to start with, and they basically started seeing activities of single cells in the visual cortex representing, you know, to various stimuli in the cat's eyes. So simple objects, they were able to kind of use simpler cells to identify, and complex objects using complex cells. And what you see in a CNN, let's say if you look at B or C, is basically trying to simplify the parameters and reducing the parameters and trying to say our brain works kind of this way. Let's try to kind of use the adjacency. Let's try to use max pooling to get the best value, the best pixel, best pixel depth, et cetera. And eventually try to come to a conclusion as, you know, we think that the brain works. Obviously, we still have to unravel those beautiful truths. And so this is a kind of a, you know, very quick introduction to CNN. So, okay, the frameworks. I see I have 5 minutes. I'm going to go real fast and try to see if I can answer at least one or two questions. So, you know, in a nutshell, if you can see, you have CAFE, Theano, Torch 7, PyTorch, TensorFlow 1.4, which is just recently released, and a couple of beautiful things like eager execution for people who have worked with TensorFlow. So if you're just, you know, very quickly going through the languages, CAFE uses C++. You know they have programming languages working at compiler level. Theano uses Python. Torch uses Lua-JIT. And interfaces, as you can see, you know, let's just focus on the Torch and TensorFlow for this instance because, you know, these are the two most popular ones, TensorFlow leading the race. So basically what you see is they both work quite well. If you look at the bottom right of that, you know, table, you know, you can use custom models, you can use capsnets. In fact, I've tested a bunch of capsnets on PyTorch and TensorFlow and Keras. So basically, a couple of differences, TensorFlow is gaining leadership and PyTorch is gaining fast popularity. And that's what I'm just going to leave you guys to. You should test the best model you choose, works for you. And Facebook, obviously, you know, they're promoting PyTorch, which I love, really, you know, it's cool. TensorFlow is also, I'm a big fan of TensorFlow, and I use these both models quite actively. So, yeah, in terms of imperatives, so, you know, TensorFlow is kind of, you know, quite direct. It doesn't care about the control flows. It says a table for two, boom, you know, and you fix it. And you just, you know, have things. So that's kind of smart in a way. You know, that kind of, you know, makes TensorFlow faster. If you put all this stuff in our computational logic in your frameworks, it goes super fast. PyTorch has, obviously, Torch has more advantages. If you can kind of define and describe your control flow. You can create your own, build your own custom build applications. So both have their advantages. All right. So this is, I'm going to go very fast. You know, these are the kind of models I have presented to companies, you know, kind of advise CEOs and a lot of people. And I'm kind of actually, you know, debunking the work that I have done myself. So I think this is useless. I've advised you guys, you know, somehow some things don't work for you guys. I don't know why. I have, you know, kind of tried everything. This is a model based on a research model, done research work done by two Swiss researchers who observed R&D organizations of companies worldwide in early 90s. And I created this model, but I realized that trying to talk to CEOs and advising them that, guys, you know, come on, you know, you got to use machine learning, deep learning, it's not coming. So one thing is happening, you know, whether these guys are using deep learning or not is competition, my friends, is using it. So I'm just putting Amazon as an example. Competition is modeling deep neural networks like crazy. 75 to 80% of Amazon's revenue comes from recommender systems, and these are going to go deeper and deeper with Alexa as they try to get deeper and deeper into, you know, into our, the complexity of our life and the thoughts and the minds and how we compute, you know, our day-to-day decisions. So if these companies, as in traditional enterprises who we have worked for or work for, do not wake up, you know, Amazon doesn't care. It's just on its path. Facebook's on its path, and Google is on its in a direction to become a multi-billion dollar company or hundreds of billions of dollar companies. So, well, what does it mean to you? Well, you shouldn't care about it. This is infographic I made a couple of years ago, 4 years ago, 5 years ago. So what happened is, if you can look on the bottom right, you see are the jobs that are going. It's also based on a research done by some really smart people, and I can send you links to those people. They are very happy to talk to you as well on LinkedIn. These are researchers from Oxford University who created this, you know, how automation is going to obliterate jobs. This is very important to me. You know what is happening in the industry is no one is telling you what you should do. If you look on the bottom, top right, are the bunch of kind of jobs that I had kind of imagined and created 4 years ago. You know, guess what? A bunch of those jobs were exactly what Udacity had designed when they came up a couple of years later. And the darker blue side of that deck on the top right are the jobs that you are going to be coming in the future, right? Space engineer, et cetera. You have to really look at it. You need to take these, you know, deep learning and what was going to happen is whether you have a physics, I'm going to move on to the next slide, whether physics or any other angle, you're going to do some awesome work. So basically, you know, try to do whatever. I have no idea how to advise you guys, big companies. So I'm going to tell you this. You know, use some whatever theory, try to make it work. At an individual level, which is what you guys matter. That's why you guys are here. Never stop. Do everything to learn. Move fast. Find the higher and steepest hill and learn. That's what I'm telling you because that's what I do every single day. Okay? Forget about the group and corporate level. That's something which companies, I'm sure if CEOs are sitting and watching, guys, you know, I have great advice to give, but ensure that you build on a cellular level, that person that's working for you. That's it. join Coursera. This is where I train and try to, you know, help people, you know, do whatever that they can to, you know, I try to provide whatever insights I have. And I try to work on LinkedIn and every other place to help you guys. So join Coursera, join Udacity, join whichever class. Get, you know, best in whatever you do. This is the book that I'm writing. It's going to be coming out next year, sometime in May or June. I hope it comes. I think it's going to be about that time for us. A lot of work and a whole lot of work going on with my clients and also public speaking stuff. But I promise to put a bunch of really cool projects. That's what, about 10 to 12, probably more, even a bunch of computational biology. Who knows? So this is coming. Now, I'm going to go quickly to the questions. So I think I – okay. So I see that the questions are more technical, which I cannot help with. Someone is asking, is there a dial number? Oh, that's a pity. I wouldn't know. I think I'm going to come back with from Bright Talk guys to see if they can answer. The other one is login problems. So, guys, you know, this is the end of the discussion. I really thank you. Appreciate it. I see 47 people. You know, I really appreciate the time that you're spending here to listen to what I have to say. All these topics are huge and deep topics. They are worth exploring. Believe me, you find time, guys. Download the research papers. Go to my GitHub. I have just created a new GitHub repository yesterday on computational biology. I'm already loading stuff. There are three projects out there. A lot more is going to come. So I really hope that you help me, you know, make this thing bigger. I cannot do it alone. I really need your help. I mean, I seriously do really need your help. I cannot really do it alone. I'm working with Google. I'm working with Facebook. And I'm working with the top scientists. And I'm also trying to use and leverage media to give me and give people I work with coverage. I'm looking forward to working with people in Syria, in Kurdistan, to just spread the message. It's about taking this and making the best out of your careers. You know, on an individual level, believe me, you can do a lot. And on a collective level, finding your like-minded souls and people who have great ideas, you can do cool stuff. So thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate it, and I look forward to your comments. And I see there are no questions, so that's all right. I am going to make a quick summary of this presentation in a blog post on Medium, on my website, and on LinkedIn, and I look forward to you guys to providing inputs, ideas, suggestions, critique, whatever. Thank you so much. Have a great day, and I will see you guys once again when I come back with some other beautiful, cool webcast. Take care, and bye-bye.